The high-end desktop PC is a mysterious and elusive beast, and while rare, it has lured many a PC builder to an untimely demise with its siren's call of maximum power. But whether you're an old-school aficionado who proudly ran an Intel Extreme Edition CPU on the LGA 1366 socket back in 2008 when high-end desktop PCs first became a thing, or a new builder looking to expand your depth of knowledge in the PC building space in general, it can help to consider this analogy when it comes to computers. Consumer desktop PCs, and specifically gaming PCs, are like race cars. Small, light, and fast, focused on delivering small payloads, like the next frame in the game that you're playing, as quickly as possible, while enterprise hardware like servers and workstations are more like semi-tractor-trailer trucks. They can move a lot more cargo, but they do it a little bit slower. Also, they are very expensive. High-end desktop PCs, by comparison, are made for consumers, but they also bring enterprise-grade features like high CPU core counts and massive amounts of connectivity, attempting to bridge the gap for home and small business users who want more power. So today I'll be testing the latest high-end desktop CPUs from AMD, the 64-core Ryzen Threadripper 7980X and the 32-core Ryzen Threadripper 7970X. Excellent. Today's video is brought to you by the Tower 200 series cases from Thermaltake, featuring a vertical tower design with a 90-degree rotated motherboard and two pre-installed CT140 fans. The Tower 200 can support huge GPUs, including the RTX 4090, without compromising airflow thanks to an abundance of filtered ventilation panels, and it also supports 280mm AIOs, standard-sized PSUs, and a sold separately 3.9-inch LCD panel kit to personalize your rig or display useful system stats. It's available in black, snow, or several unique shades of green, so for more on Thermaltake's The Tower 200 series cases, click the sponsor link in the video description. I have three things to discuss to provide some context for my review, but as always, feel free to use the timestamps to jump to the results if you so desire. But then, you'd miss out on the context. Firstly, I am approaching this review from a personal point of view, because I have been a longtime fan of high-end desktop PCs, and I did rock an Intel Core i7-920 and an LGA 1366 motherboard for quite some time back in my Newegg days. I also use 2nd and 3rd gen Threadripper CPUs in my two primary computers, and I am quite happy with them. Almost all of my videos that you've watched in recent years have been rendered with a Threadripper CPU. However, because those CPUs are in use in systems that are kind of mission critical around here, I cannot easily pop them out to run updated benchmarks, and I also do not have access to the more recent Pro lines of workstation CPUs that had all but supplanted actual high-end desktop offerings until this week, which includes AMD EPYC server processors, the AMD Threadripper Pro 5000 series, and Intel's current Sapphire Rapids workstation lineup, and the flagship Xeon W9-3495X. Those are all made for professional use, and are theoretically the direct competitors for the 7970X and 7980X, and if you want some data on those, I highly recommend the Level 1 Text channel, which I'll link in the description, as well. Wendell should also have a review up today or very soon. I will instead focus on a different customer, the well-to-do PC gamer who has already attained peak performance on the consumer desktop side of things with something like an Intel 14900K or an AMD 7950X3D, but still desires something more, whether that be more power to accomplish non-gaming tasks for a home business or professional work, or simply more bragging rights when listing your system specs for jealous fellow gamers. The second thing I wanted to mention is that I could not help but get a little excited about setting up my first STR5 testbed. Threadripper CPUs have been using the carrier frame and including a Torx screwdriver in the box since first gen, and that hasn't changed, although the retail box is a lot smaller now. It's Ryzen desktop sized, which I didn't mind, but it still includes the screwdriver and an Asetek AIO compatible CPU cooler retention bracket, which provides compatibility with a decent number of existing liquid coolers since the mount has not changed versus STR4. To install, you lift the retention bracket, slide out the dummy carrier frame, slide in the Threadripper processor in its carrier frame, remove the protective socket cover, and lower the retention bracket until it snaps in place. Then tighten the three Torx screws in the order indicated on the CPU socket cover, noting that the screwdriver will click when the proper torque is reached. Then broadly apply thermal paste for maximum contact with your AIO block, and it's good to go. The third thing I wanted to note is that I have chosen my software test suite with care, so anyone with a 14900K, 7950X3D, or similar CPU can get a good idea of what a Threadripper 7K upgrade will or won't do for them. I have a set of compute tests which are way more practical for making use of a 32-core or 64-core processor, as well as gaming tests run at 1080p and 4K. 1080 because lower resolutions are typically more CPU bound and will demonstrate performance differences between CPUs more clearly, and 4K because anyone who is considering a gaming PC upgrade to Threadripper had better already be running the best GPU possible, which for now is the RTX 4090 and probably also a high refresh rate 4K resolution monitor. Here are the stats and specs for the four CPUs I'm testing today. The biggest drawback for the Threadrippers is the price, no question about it. $5,000 and $2,500, although it should be noted that the 24-core Threadripper 7960X will cost $1,500 and be the most cost-effective option, although I do not have that model for testing. And yes, cost-effective is a very relative term here. The 7970X boosts to 5.3 GHz, theoretically a bit higher than the 7980X, which should give it a leg up in those race car tasks where speed is more important, such as gaming. Note that the memory setup features quad channel support and also requires RDIMMs, which are not compatible with mainstream DDR5 DIMMs. And then there's the most disappointing thing about this launch for me stats-wise, which will affect some more than others, which is that AMD decided to limit the PCIe lanes on Threadripper non-pro to 48 to segment those high-end desktop CPUs from the workstation Threadrippers that support 128 PCIe lanes. So while you do get double the 24 PCIe lanes available on mainstream AM5, it is still less than half of what is actually available on this platform by design. So if your system's use case involves quad GPUs or mass amounts of NVMe SSDs, you might run out of PCIe lanes sooner than you'd expect and be pushed towards the even more expensive WRX90 platform for Threadripper Pro model CPUs. Meanwhile, the flagship mainstream CPUs aren't looking quite as pricey by comparison, especially with recent price drops that brought the 14900K to $580, less than its tray price from just a month back, and the 7950X3D is going for about $600 these days. Here's a look at the hardware for my testbed setups, focusing on the STR5 testbed since the others are the same from last month. The review kit included an ASUS Pro WS TRX50 Sage Wi-Fi motherboard with a rotated socket, four RDIMM slots, and active cooling fans on both power delivery arrays. For memory, we have a 128GB kit. That's four 32GB sticks of G-Skill Zeta R5 Neo DDR5 6400 CL32 memory. And for the CPU cooler, we have a 360mm all-in-one, the NZXT Kraken 360, which is comparable in performance to the Corsair H150i Elite LCD that I used on the mainstream testbeds. And for the GPU, we're of course going with the fastest one available, which is the RTX 4090, represented by the Founders Edition from NVIDIA. I'm running clean installations of Windows 11 22H2, and motherboards have their XMP or XPO profiles enabled, along with the settings shown here. Here's a quick look at CPU temperatures, which might be familiar if you watched coverage of the 7950X or 7950X3D, since these CPUs use the same Zen 4 dies and are supposed to peak at 95 degrees Celsius. In certain tasks, such as handbrake video transcoding, the 7980X can definitely do that too. It peaked at 97.5C on one die in my tests, although no throttling was reported by Hardware Info. The 7970X also got into the red, peaking above 96C and actually running slightly hotter on average since it was sustaining slightly higher clock speeds for longer periods of time than the 7980X, although both CPUs peaked at 5.64 GHz, a decent boost over their listed clock speeds. Here are some power draw numbers, including the peak CPU package power draw across all tests and the full system power draw for Blender, which is in blue, which is the best real-world comparison of power draw for just the CPU. I'm also reporting total system wattage for a couple games, which includes the power draw for the RTX 4090. This is the 14900K's most shameful metric, as it was pushing up pretty close to the 7970X for gaming power draw, although to be fair, the 14900K was getting more frames out of the 4090, which you'll see in a moment. And now it's time for the benchmarks, starting with Cinebench R23 using all cores and threads. Remember, the 14900K and 7950X3D have 32 threads each. The 7970X doubles that to 64, and the 7980X doubles that again to 128. The 7980X wins, of course. It is about 2.5 times faster than the 14900K, but it's not exactly linear scaling by thread count. Here are the single thread scores where the race car will beat the semi, so the rankings are flipped and the 6 GHz 14900K is 20% faster than the 7980X. The 7970X's slight frequency edge over the 7980X is demonstrated here as well. CPU mark is part of the Passmark performance test, now updated to version 11, and in the multi-threaded tests, the 7980X dominates again with a score 2.1 times higher than the 14900K, with the 7970X splitting the difference. In CPU Mark's single-threaded test, the 14900K again scored a win, with rankings similar to the Cinebench single-thread tests. Adobe Photoshop 2024 was tested with the Puget Bench extension, version 0.93.7, and Photoshop has favored Intel's IPC performance for some time, so no change here as the 14900K takes the lead. Adobe Premiere 2023, meanwhile, does favor more cores and threads for some aspects of the test, such as raw video transcoding, for example, which allowed the Threadripper CPUs to take the win. But it did not favor more than 64 threads, it appears, since the 7970X edged out the 7980X. The free and open source 3D creation suite known as Blender is next, version 3.6, open data 3.1. As if to make up for the anemic performance in the Adobe tests, the 7980X came roaring back here, 1,671.2 samples per minute, 3.2 times the 14900K score, and the 7970X doubled it. These CPUs are beastly for Blender. Next, we have video transcoding via Handbrake, processing a 4K video down to 1080p with the fast preset. The encoding speed is shown as a frame rate, and this chart is confusing because the values are sort of flipped, but the Threadripper is one. Moving on to V-Ray by Chaos Group, it makes photoreal imagery and animations. The 7980X's score of 82,912 was again more than 3.2 times faster than the 14900K, while the 7870X easily broke 50,000. The Corona renderer comes standalone or as a plugin for 3D Studio Max or Cinema 4D, and we're looking at time to render, so lower is better. The 7980X burned through the test in just 13 seconds, and the 7970X took only 20. Rounding out our compute tests, we have 7-Zip testing basic file compression and decompression. In the compression test, we notch another win for the 7980X at 350,000 MIPS, with the 7970X not far behind at 300K. In decompression, the 7970X even edges out its big brother by about 6,000 MIPS, with the 14900K coming in last. Moving on to gaming benchmarks, where I've tested all the games at 1080p and 4K, and once again our GPU is NVIDIA's RTX 4090 Founders Edition. Starting with Far Cry 6, where at 4K the 14900K begins to exact its revenge, claiming the number one spot at 165.5 frames per second. The Threadrippers aren't too far behind, less than 10%, although frame consistency could be an issue looking at the 1% lows. At 1080, where CPU limitations are more pronounced, the 7950X 3D grabs the win, while reminding you that it has 3D V-Cache. The Threadrippers struggled even more here, with the last place 7970X about 26% behind the 7950X 3D. Next we have Shadow of the Tomb Raider, where at 4K the Threadrippers are a little bit slower, but it's only like 2-3%, and 1% lows are looking reasonable too. So let's try 1080, where the 7950X 3D takes another win, leaving the 7980X and 7970X 21 and 26% behind, respectively. Although again, reasonable 1% lows. In Cyberpunk 2077 at 4K, we once again had very similar average frame rates, with the 14900K edging out a win. The 7980X's 1% lows are again a concern, but Cyberpunk might just not know what to do with all of those cores. When we switch to 1080 this time, the 32-thread CPUs once again pull out in front, with the 14900K taking the win and the Threadrippers about 25% behind. Horizon Zero Dawn is next, using the Favor Quality preset, and at 4K it's all about the AMD CPUs, with a nod to the 7950X 3D, but similar performance all around, although once again a bit short on the 1% lows for the 7980X. In the 1080 results, Intel's 14900K edged out the 7950X 3D by less than half a frame, and the Threadrippers fell behind by about 10%. And lastly, we have Starfield, a new title in my mix which was running with the high graphics preset, and I must confess that even though these are recent benchmarks that were run within 1 month of each other, with the rate that Starfield has been receiving updates, there's a good chance that my 14900K and 7950X 3D results aren't reflecting some software-based performance benefits. So at 4K, the Threadrippers were out in front. Asterisk. At 1080, the 14900K and 7950X 3D were still ahead, with the Threadrippers down by about 16%, while still managing to output about 110 frames per second. And that is all for my gaming benchmarks. And now for my favorite part, the summary comparisons. Using the 14900K as our zero point, here are my compute and gaming results across all multi-threaded tests for compute and the five games tested for gaming. The 7950X3D has a slight edge over the 14900K still, but those green bars show that Threadripper can offer a significant boost to compute tasks, although your mileage may vary depending on the task in question. The semi-truck nature of Threadripper is still evident in the 1080 gaming scores, where performance lags by 15 to 20%, but if you move to 4K, a much more likely resolution for a PC with this caliber of hardware, games are less CPU bound and performance is much more comparable, although Threadripper is still a frame or three behind. But let's also compare the prices. And yes, the $5,000 asking price for the 7980X makes those performance variances seem much less impactful. It's a shame you can't just buy two, three, or four 7950X3Ds or 14900Ks and get additive performance by stacking them up or something, because that would be way more cost effective. But cost effectiveness has never really been the strong point for high-end desktop PCs. They are a halo product, a premium platform designed for those who can turn that extra CPU horsepower into more money or more time by putting their PC to work, and then maybe also having the flexibility to achieve peak gaming performance, or near peak at least, when the work is done and it's time for fun. Practically speaking though, these new CPUs from AMD are not very practical for the typical gamer. You would need to save yourself a lot of time and money to make up for a price that's 5 to 10 times what you'd currently pay for a 32-thread mainstream CPU. And maybe that's why AMD never launched Threadripper 5000 non-pro CPUs. Mainstream options cover the vast majority of what home users would need, and they're better for gaming too. High-end desktop Threadrippers offer a niche option to an already niche group of power users. Still, I'm glad AMD decided to go forward with the Threadripper 7000 non-pro CPUs, as well as the pro ones, because I happen to be in that select group. So maybe my opinion is biased, but what do you guys think? Let me know in the comment section down below, especially if you're actually considering a Threadripper TRX 50 build. I hope this review helps you guys out. Hit the thumbs up button before you go. If you enjoyed the video, check out my store at paulshardware.net for shirts and other cool stuff you can buy. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and stay tuned for lots more content coming at you soon as we wind down 2023, including an awesome Threadripper build for my editor, Joe. Thanks again, guys, and we'll see you in the next video.